have some more joining in, but thought it's best to start. My name is Nimai Mehta, and I will be chairing this session on the rewards and perils of teamwork. What can we teach, or can it be taught? Joining me on the panel are colleagues from four different disciplinary fields. Professor Anna Amirkhanian, did I pronounce that right?
Okay.
Is from public administration. Professor David Lovison here to my left is from COGOT Business Management. Professor John Willoughby is from the Economics Department. And we have Professor Gay Young from Sociology. So I've requested my colleagues to respond to two main questions for this session. Question one, what should we expect students to learn about teamwork or successful teamwork as it occurs in the real world? Question two is, how should we teach teamwork and evaluate students within an education setting where individual performance and effort are the primary sources of assessment and grading? So we've divided this session into two parts so that we can consider these questions separately. And the first part will focus on the what question, the what of learning teamwork, and we plan to devote about just under 30 minutes for that part, including 10 minutes of general discussion and open it up to the rest of you for Q&A. And we will take up the how of teaching teamwork in the second part, for which we've devoted about 45 minutes, including about 20 minutes for general Q&A from the audience. So I'm going to start off part one by highlighting why I think we should be thinking of both the how and the what of teaching teamwork in designing our class assignments. Many of us have used team-based assignments in class. Students generally enjoy working as teams, and they find the experience rewarding. But things get far more challenging when you start assessing their grades based on team performance rather than individual effort. And the challenge that emerges is that however well one may design the team assignment, there's an inevitable mismatch between measurable individual effort, real or perceived, and team performance. The mismatch is inherent, I believe, to teamwork and is generated by the presence of diverse skill sets within the team, a diverse set of work habits, and free riding, all of which are difficult to monitor and measure. And one way to think of this is the only way possibly to get rid of this challenge is to have a team that consists of robots or clones. And maybe we will be getting closer to that sort of a context, but we are not quite there yet. And I think until then, I think there is this challenge to deal with, this mismatch between individual effort and linking individual effort with team performance and then rewarding effort based on that. So as I said, there's no easy solution to this, and students, especially I find the high-achieving ones, often complain bitterly about the unfairness of team-based grading. So what to do? Well, one response is to tell students to suck it up, to suggest that life is unfair, and that they better get used to it early. Now, as a general bit of advice, that's probably there is a good lot of truth to that. But I think it's misleading, and it's not very useful in terms of this context of having students learn about teamwork, especially as you prepare them for the real world. And I think that the fact that advice is not very helpful is evident when you start looking at real-world successful examples of teamwork. Teamwork in the real world employs a mix of, I think, three elements: effective leadership, incentives, and motivational strategies or norms to achieve successful team results. And these are all based on rewarding team performance while continuing to motivate individual effort in the face of perceived and real mismatches between that individual effort and the quality of the team output. So now while we can look at these real-world examples of successful teamwork to inform our design of the class assignments, I'm out of time. Okay, I'm going to exercise my privilege taking an additional few seconds here. Well, the bottom line is that one can find these real-world examples, but the interesting thing is that the context and the mix of incentives, leadership, and norms that seem to produce effective teamwork varies across the context. And so if you go to the U.S. Army and you see how they use these three elements, you'll find invariably they're quite different from how a car dealership uses it or how a startup in the tech sector uses it. So that gets down to the question that I'm going to raise in the first part and ask my colleagues to respond is, what exactly should we be teaching these students about the real-world context of teamwork? So let me start with Guy Young. What do you think we should be teaching students about successful teamwork, or what particular real-world context would you like to highlight when you teach students?
You gonna start my clock? No, it's okay. I hope most of you were just at the plenary, because there's a sense in which part of what I want to address does follow rather directly from some of what Professor Grunwald was saying. I want to think of teamwork as a form of cooperative learning, specifically cooperation by design, and I'm very serious about the idea of cooperation by design. This is based on a strategy that isn't new. Some of you may have some awareness of it, a jigsaw strategy, where group members do work as a team to accomplish a goal, but the work itself is structured in a very particular way, such that each member of the team has an essential part to play, a different and essential part to play in the academic activity. So this is a deliberate interdependence that is being structured in to foster engagement, but also to foster valuing others as key contributors to the common task. As I say, this is not new. This is actually something that was developed literally in the 70s when, in the wake of the civil rights movement, in Texas specifically, well-intended efforts to desegregate the public schools were leading to a range of problems, arising in part from the fact that what we saw was racial ethnic minority kids who had attended underfunded schools being in classrooms composed of predominantly privileged white kids. What we were seeing was, as a result of this structural inequality, situations in which students from impoverished backgrounds appeared to be, in their struggles, appeared to be confirming stereotypes and prejudices held largely by the dominant society. Blacks and Latinos are less competent, less hardworking, in contrast to whites who are ambitious and competitive. And so what we're getting was strained social relations and widening gaps in the achievement between students of color and white students. So a social psychologist, Elliot Aronson, with whom I did not work, but I did work with one of his students, developed this idea of the jigsaw classroom technique, now typically referred to as the jigsaw strategy, as an answer to this set of issues. The point was to deliberately transform what was a competitive set of dynamics in the classroom to a set of cooperative dynamics in the classroom. The idea is to structure cohesion and cooperative social relations among team members who are from different social groupings, very deliberately. So, one of the crucial effects, transformative effects, that does result from a high-quality cooperative learning process is that students begin to get past some of their preformed perceptions or, as was discussed earlier, implicit biases about one another. This is probably, from my perspective, the most important reason for doing this kind of work. Interpersonal collaborative skills that can be learned in cooperative learning activities are certainly relevant to personal and professional success later, things like active listening, things like communicating ideas, opinions, concerns effectively, collective decision making, resolving conflicts without personal attacks. So, as the university, this university, enrolls more students who are not members of the dominant social groups in society, there are structures within this institution that, in my biased view of the world, are in need of transformation. We're not simply going to be able to do an add and stir sort of system, which I think is where we have largely been. And the jigsaw technique, I think, is one of the things that can be implemented in a classroom setting. Studies, we want data, do indeed reveal enhanced academic performance across the board, reductions in stereotypes and prejudices, especially among members of the dominant group toward members of the disadvantaged groups, improve social relations among students from differing social groupings, that is, among students who are located differently on significant dimensions of social inequality, race and class, but also gender and sexuality. The key is mutual interdependence. And I'll talk about an assignment in the how part that, albeit imperfect, is something that I have done.
Thank you. Okay. John, you've worked on issues of, or at least in the one paper I saw, you worked on issues of labor productivity and issues of fairness. Would you like to bring some of that, those insights in?
Yeah. This is an article that I wrote with a psychologist. It's way outside what I usually do. Got published in the Journal of Economic Psychology. And to my surprise, it's been probably more cited than most other things that I've done, and which I divided students into different groups to do a fairly mindless task, which is to collate syllabi for me. And I would pay them different rates, and I wanted to see what the impact was on productivity. And I won't go into the details, but I paid them different rates, and I divided them into two groups. In one group, the people didn't know what the others were being paid, and in the other group, everyone knew what everyone else was being paid, and the pays were differential. So they were aware that they were being treated differently. And I got very different results from these groups who were receiving the same pay in a state of ignorance and the same pay in a state of knowledge. Got very different results. And the interesting thing I found is that when people knew what other people were getting, they behaved like they were according to what economic theory would predict. But when they didn't know, they all behaved the same. They tended to work in a, and they actually tended to have better performance as well. Because they were assuming a fairness, I think. That was my interpretation. They were assuming fairness. Together. Mm-hmm. So this raises some difficult issues, I think, for assessment in when you're constructing teamwork in a classroom, because it's clear to the professor normally who's doing more work in a team as opposed to someone else. And this could be for a variety of reasons, some of which I think Gay touched on, and it might not just be due to competence reasons, but other reasons as well. And so my tendency then is to, we're getting into the how part, but my tendency has been to just give everyone the same grade in the group, so the whole group is graded by the group's output, mm-hmm. Knowing that this can exacerbate what economists call free rider problems, and also problems in which the students who are more driven by grades will take over the work from everybody else just to ensure that the small group gets the right grade, the correct grade. And I haven't solved this problem in teamwork. I find advantages to doing group projects. I teach a course on the Arab world, and I like to divide my students into different country groups, so they can do different country studies. And I think it's better if they work together and take advantage of their different skills. And I think they actually learn more about the country by working together than they would if just in a normal individual framework. But on the other hand, I my groups are always plagued with free rider problems. and so I'm interested in what other people say about that.
Thank you. Dave, you come from the business side, and this is of clear interest to business to ensure, on one hand, the productivity of the team output and the value of the quality of the team output, but on the other hand, make sure also that individual merit is recognized and promoted through business. Would you like to bring in the business perspective here?
Thank you. Thank you. I'm happy to. By the way, I'm not texting. I have my notes on this. although people have said it makes me look like a 20-year-old, so I kind of like the image. I think there are three things that we need to be considering when we try to position the use of teams or team exercises in our classroom. And these relate directly to what I think the expectations of our graduates are when they get into the business world. So I may come across as somewhat instrumental, but I'm trying to be very, very specific here. The first one is I think we should be stressing more the fact that teams are the operational unit of the corporation today. In other words, yes, there are such things as individual contributors, but all of the great challenges that organizations are trying to face are done through teams. You know, developing new products, done through teams. Solving major issues, done through teams. Trying to become innovative, typically done through teams, although usually there's some sort of lead breakthrough innovator. So if we're not positioning this as a necessary skill like critical thinking and writing, I think we're hurting our students. The second thing is I think that we owe it to our students to help them understand what good teams look like versus what bad teams look like. Prior to going into academia, I spent 20-some years in industry, and you know the examples of teams that were dysfunctional and unproductive are legion. It's easier to find those examples than it is to find examples of good teamwork. And when I've done workshops and other things for people, they pointed out interesting comments like, "I've never been told or taught how to work on a team." So if you think about that and you say, well, if most of the examples they're going to encounter are bad, if nobody really has really been taught to work on a team, how are they going to be the good team member, right? How are they going to be the ones that create the good teams? And by the way, we shouldn't absolve ourselves, because in the classroom, if you start asking students about their experiences in team assignments, there's always that free rider they're upset about, and they had to work extra because they had to make up for it. So I think the second thing is really this idea of what does a good versus a bad team look like. And I think the third thing that we should be stressing is that most of our graduates are going to get their auditions for management by virtue of how they work on a team. I mean, if you think about it, why would you promote somebody to be a manager? Yeah, in a very task-specific sort of environment, yes, if you're a great analyst or you're a great whatever, yeah, you're going to get a leg up on everyone else. But leadership or management is this idea of being able to manage others. And when do you get a chance to do that? By how you operate on a team. So if students are going to be placed on teams, if students are going to be given the opportunity to be the good team versus the bad team, it really represents an opportunity that we should be stressing, which is this is how you're going to be singled out as somebody who's capable of management. Mm-hmm. And until we do that, I think we're not hurting our students, but I think we're not really giving them the full story of what's expected, at least in the business world, which I can only speak about. Okay. So thank you.
Thanks. We've got a little more time left here, and I want to press the my colleagues here to talk a little more about perhaps on the fact that these contexts, real-world contexts, do differ, not just within businesses and industries, but across these different sectors, between the public and private sector, mm-hmm. Across cultures, across gender. Is there a common set of norms or that would make for a good team player that we should be targeting when we think of these assignments? Or should we be preparing our students, depend in our own respective fields, for that particular context we think the student is going to go into once he or she graduates?
You asking me to start? I think we're in an environment now where students are going to change careers as much as students a generation ago might have changed jobs. Mm-hmm. And consequently, the context is going to vary. So yes, to some extent, if we're at COGOD and we're training business students, we're going to go into the kind of business environment or business situations that we would anticipate. I think we can be a little bit more programmed, if you will, in terms of how we orient them. But I tend to think of teamwork, collaboration, however you want to lump all those things together, as being more of a generic skill, like critical thinking, right? We put a great emphasis on communication and critical thinking, but we don't necessarily funnel it toward any particular area. We see it as a general skill or a general attribute. And I think the same sort of thing could probably be stated toward teamwork. At the end of the day, we need to work on teams as collaborators, research collaborators, the same way that they're likely to have to work with public, private, and all sorts of other different environments. So I'm less prone to say that we, you know, I'm more prone to think of it as a general skill that should be learned and applied anywhere, which means that all of us can be doing it, I think. It's not restricted to the business.
Anyone else like to comment on that?
Joanne?
I would follow up just a bit with what Dave said, and I think that maybe taking one step back, and that is modeling effective team building. Mm-hmm. That I think that if people are going to be expected, and certainly this is a message that I communicate readily and frequently, that you will work in teams when you work, almost certainly. And yes, there are a lot of bad examples out there, but thinking about ways to model effective team building, mm-hmm. And this is sort of part of what I think the jigsaw model helps us do, is one way of thinking about how to build a team that not only works effectively, but also moves past, I think, some of the things that were talked about earlier in terms of implicit biases, has ways of disabling some of those implicit biases.
Okay. And I think we're all going to talk about some aspect of how to do that. Yeah, thank you.
John, do you have anything to add?
And did you want to say something?
Absolutely. I guess I would extend the contingency theory of leadership to group work to some degree. Mm. So in leadership, we say, at least there's one theory that says effective leaders and effective leaders' skills depend on the context. So if you're dealing with organizations with very specific goals, with a lot of resources and people who are on board with a strategy and the objective, then one leadership style may be more effective, maybe more task-oriented. Whereas if you're dealing with an organization with very vague goals and lack of support and a lot of opposing coalitions, then a more relationship-oriented leadership style is relevant. So if you extend this to kind of the group work strategies, I think our goal should be to educate students to understand the complexity of the context, to be able to disentangle different aspects of your policy environment, whether you're in homeland security or environmental policy or in different areas of business, and to have a toolbox available to you and be able to select between those tools. So we shouldn't be giving them a tool to use at any point, and one-size-fits-all approach rarely works in management. Yeah. It should be a toolbox, and we should just educate them on the complexities that they should be able to detect and then select the right tool. And I think it's true for management, leadership, and for teamwork. Mm.
Well, why don't we just go ahead?
So let's open it up to the audience and see if you'd like to raise some issues that you think are would be interesting and we've not touched on. You've got about 10 minutes. Yes, please go ahead.
I just love some more house. You know, I know how I'm trying to teach and evaluate what kind of assignments I'm doing, but I'd love to hear from you all how you're, because just throwing students in teams doesn't make them better teammates.
No, no.
Team members. So just love some strategies.
Yeah. So perhaps we can wait for part two to get into a response for that. But any questions on the what of students should be learning about being successful team players? Yes.
Yes, I have a small question, and I really like the models you guys give to us. But I just I feel like everything it seems like a systematic model over there. But how to avoid like human issues? I mean, like power issues, something like that among the students. How can you guys? I mean, like professors. Detect those kind of issue and avoid that. And that lot of things going on. I know it's not, it's like kind of naive, but it's true.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's a really difficult issue.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes I've toyed with the idea, I've never actually done this, but I've toyed with the idea of trying to identify the students who I think are weakest in a certain skill, and trying to mold the team so that they have to present in something that they're not very comfortable in doing, rather than leaving it to the more powerful person who has the skill to do that. Because I think, for me, the goal isn't necessarily to have a great product, but to try to build their capabilities, the students' capabilities. That means, for me anyway, that grading is sort of secondary, that I can do assessments in other arenas, but maybe assessment for team doesn't work quite as well, especially if you're trying to structure things so that the product you're producing isn't as good as it might be if you just let the best student take over and do it all by themselves. So I think it's a difficult problem, and I can't say I've been tremendously successful, but I think that's something I'd like to do in teams, is try to identify students who need help in learning how to work in teams and get them to work in the teams and become leaders rather than just followers.
Yeah, to follow up a response to this?
Yeah, to add to that, I think that the strategy of a faculty member should not be to avoid those issues, but to teach students how to address them.
Exactly.
You can't avoid socio-emotional processes in groups, in real world, or in the classroom. And I think the goal should be to have tools and channels of communication open so that you know about these issues early on, and so that students have the skills in terms of how to address them. And I'll talk about some of them.
If I may just add to that, we are going to talk, I think all of us are going to talk about that in the how, but Richard Hackman, who is, well, he's not deceased, but he's a noted team scholar, said that the role of leaders in teams is to set the conditions for the team to be successful. And I think a lot of what we're going to talk about in the how is about how those conditions can be demonstrated in the classroom or set in classroom settings that could also apply to real-world sort of settings. But I agree with Anna completely. We'd be doing our students, I believe, a disservice if we tried to isolate them from what's, in fact, they're going to encounter 1,000 times worse in the business world, where the stakes aren't just a grade. The stakes are, you know, promotion, firing, all kinds of other things. So it gets hairy out there.
I'm Gihan Fernando. I head the Career Center here, and we have been a very instrumental way in trying to help students both understand and then learn more about the broad skill sets that employers are desiring. And every survey I have seen that's credible has teamwork as a highly desired skill among the, you know, in the very top ranks, typically right after written and oral communication and kind of the broad skill sets that people are looking for. But this morning, we just did a session as part of the conference on those skill sets and how to help faculty to think about helping students draw those, develop those skill sets and articulate them effectively to prospective employers. So one of the participants in that session asked a question which I'd love to get some of your reactions to, which is, so your session title is kind of posed as a question, right? Can you teach teamwork? And it seems like we're implicitly answering that in the affirmative. But there was a question about students who either might not desire to work in a setting where they require a lot of team work, or might have a disability, or perhaps less formally be more introverted perhaps, and prefer to work individually. And how do you deal with those issues, particularly the disability issue, to accommodate that in assignments, and how do you teach effectively on teamwork for such students?
Mm-hmm. Anybody like to take that?
But that's part of the how, I think, that will come up. We'll maybe just another question and we'll move to how. Since that seems to be the issue.
I come from the domain of student involvement through student activities as an associate director for leadership development. So my challenge has been facilitating team building within our executive boards for our student clubs. Will part of the how be utilizing debrief as a rhetoric tool for helping them think about building their capacity for team work? Because one of the challenges that I'm experiencing in the student club domain is that students are pressure prompted and focused on the next thing, not taking the value of the debrief as something to help them internalize what they've experienced in terms of their active learning and then being able to share some of their challenges and concerns. Because the question is it part of the how in utilizing debrief tactics? And then the second question, with attention back to your question about the emotional issues, how is there a part of the how in talking about the intercultural difficulties around the definitions of leadership? Because where, in a more Western perspective, leadership is seen as one thing, in a more Eastern perspective, such on and so forth, and how then when we get into these mixing pots and experimental labs, what happens when they come face to face with that?
I can just mention very quickly that I had exactly this experience just last semester with a student that came to me having with a disability note. And he was part of a team that included a student from Korea, from South Korea. And it's the South Korean student who brought this to my attention at the end of the semester. And I have a direct quote from the student here that I can share later in the how. But these are issues that one has to deal with in a way that is productive. Yes. So they're part of a wide set of handicaps that students have to deal with in successfully managing teamwork and team assignments. So let's move on to the how part of the session. Let me start with Anna, because you've been done quite an extensive amount of development on team using team-based assignments in the classroom. So why don't you take about 5 minutes and describe some of them.
Great, thank you. I'll preface my section by saying that I don't do research on teamworks or team building and facilitation, but I do use it extensively in my coursework. And I teach two very different courses, statistics and capstone and public administration. One is very structured with a lot of quizzes and homeworks and right and wrong answers, and it has a group project. And the other one is more discussion-based, critical thinking is involved, often no right and wrong answer. So that influences the nature of teamwork and what I do as a professor in those two settings immensely. So I'll focus on several aspects of my experience. And the first one that I wanted to touch upon is the optimal degree of professors' involvement and management of teams by the professor. So I found that graduate students, at least in our program, are often not prepared to participate in teamwork. So I have to start by putting in place some ground rules for their teamwork. And so there are some things that I absolutely require, there are some things that I recommend, and some things that I leave it up to them to decide how to handle those issues. So I require equal effort or more or less equal contribution in terms of the amount of time, participation in meetings, and parts of the final project that they submit. I set very clear and strict expectations in terms of the end result, and I set expectations for mutual respect and communication style between people on teams. The rest is recommended, so I provide recommended schedule of what needs to be accomplished week by week throughout the semester, and then I tell them, it's up to you if you want to follow my schedule or if you want to develop a different schedule, that's up to you. I advise them on a good balance between in-class discussions versus email versus in-person discussion. Just give them some examples of how to do that. I tell them about how to make sure that their group meetings are more efficient, how to share data and files. So there's a lot of recommended frameworks and tools that I share, but I try to not micromanage. And I check in with them almost weekly, and two or three times per semester I have a more in-depth 10-minute discussion with every group to make sure that I know how they're doing. And I also open a lot of channels of communication for them so they're aware that I'm here for them if there are any issues. So there's some flexibility, but there's also some structure there. On motivating teamwork in the classroom, I find that it's very important to motivate students to be on teams. Many of our students work full-time, and so it's a struggle for them to meet outside the classroom and do field work and to sit through those group meetings. Also, obviously, a situation where your grade depends on somebody else's contribution is not a desirable situation. So I usually spend some time early on explaining that in my field, in public and nonprofit management, you will be working in groups. And actually, it's good if you experience situations where someone is not contributing enough, or, which is more common in our program, you'll have people who are very controlling and they would like to control every single aspect of the paper. And you have multiple people like that on the team, so how do you resolve that? So I actually tell them you shouldn't think of group work as a format for your assignment, but it's a learning experience in and of itself, and you will come out of it with more skills. And so just like you mentioned, there are some students who are just reluctant to get engaged in group work, and there I can do some convincing. And there are students with emotional health issues or other health issues. And early on, I try to clarify that for myself. I've had a student with a pretty severe ADD who couldn't talk or couldn't concentrate in group discussions. And I'll give you a more specific example. In the context of my office, when I would discuss issues with him or topics, we had to turn off the clock on my wall because the noise of the clock would distract him, something that I wouldn't even hear. So we've actually learned how to develop different strategies for that team member to provide written assessments and feedback to the group so that the group knows that he's very engaged. It's hard for him to contribute during in-class discussions. On forming teams, I actually use very different approaches in different classes. In the public administration capstone, I want them to be interested in the same thing. So students who are interested in homeland security are on their team, environmental policy, their own team, budgeting, financial management, their own team. So I ask them about their substantive interest. In stats, I've actually noticed that the more diverse the team is, the better they do. If it's a team of very strong students, they don't challenge each other and they submit something that's very simple and they don't go beyond. If it's a team of weaker students, then they struggle a lot. Whereas if there are students with different levels of preparation and comfort with math, they ask interesting questions and they challenge each other, and the result is usually much more advanced and better quality than students who are in less diverse groups. So I think the type of a course matters. Another issue that I think every professor should think about and talk to their students is the extent of co-production versus delegation in teams. So with many students working full-time, it's hard for them to go through every aspect of the project throughout the whole semester. So they really have to discuss that question. Are we going to delegate and do things separately or do everything together and kind of have control over the entire process? So that's something that I usually discuss. I provide a lot of feedback and coaching in terms of how to make sure that the meetings are efficient. So you have to set objectives, you have to designate roles, you have to let everyone speak, you have to listen and hear each other. What's your body language? I do a few exercises to make sure that, so I will not describe the exercises, but they're basically designed to ensure that they learn that their body language matters. And if you turn your back, and it might be a student with an ADD, it might be an overweight student, and you would observe over the years when you teach, you would observe that people tend to do that. And so you have to actually explicitly say, what's your body language? Make sure that you're equally open to all members of your team and don't all turn your back to this one particular student for whatever reason. We discuss quite extensively the ratio of social versus professional processes on teams. Obviously, students like to talk about their cats, dogs, boyfriends, mothers in groups, and I usually tell them, start with the professional part, start with your job and the objectives. When you're done, and if you still have a little bit of time, it's fine to network and build camaraderie and talk about other things. On use of IT in group work, I remind students of the many possibilities and tools that they have. I use Blackboard, I tell them about Dropbox, which is free, I tell them about Google Docs, and I let them decide what to do with those. Two other things that are important, and I'll mention them briefly. Obviously, evaluating teamwork is very difficult. In both of my courses, group projects are worth about 35% of the final grade, and I found that more than that, students get really concerned that their individual grade depends on other contributions. So I keep it to like 30% or less. And I typically assign one grade to all members of the team, but I reiterate many, many times that every student has to contribute to the same degree in terms of the final project. And again, open channels of communication so that students feel comfortable to come to me and say, it's not going very well. Can you please speak to one member of our team to make sure that their product is fine? And usually, if I hear about those instances early on, I can work with that student to make sure that their contribution is about the same as that of the rest of the students. regrettably, sometimes, and it happened last semester, a group came to me 10 hours before the final product was due to let me know that there's this one person who did not do anything throughout the semester. And it was a friend of theirs and a charming person, and that kind of contributed to this situation where they felt reluctant to complain. A couple times I've observed students being, you know, amazingly prepared to like schedule interventions with a student who is not doing very well and kind of face them and tell them how they feel about their contribution to the project. Something that I started thinking as I was preparing for this panel, that in all of these cases it was intervention directed at a female student. Mm-hmm. And I've never seen an intervention directed at a male student when they're not performing well. So I don't know if this is just I'm seeing that or there's something that's really going on. And the last very quick point, desirability of formal and informal group work. I do have formal group projects in my classes, but I also know that students informally get together and they do study groups. So sometimes it's absolutely fine to do that, but in courses that are more structured and when there are individual tests, midterms, and final exams, sometimes students that are part of study teams do well in the study group and then they take their midterm and they fail. And that's because sometimes when they participate in a study group, they have a distorted understanding of how they're doing independently. So I recommend that they study independently a certain part of their time or preparation and don't overdo that informal kind of teamwork when they prepare for individual tests. Okay, that's it.
Thank you, Anna. John, would you like to jump in on the how part?
Sure.
At this point?
Yeah. I have... I think there are three things that I agree largely with what Anna is saying, but I just want to boil down to three things that I do, or I have sometimes done, which have worked. I've really had two approaches to teamwork. One has been unsuccessful, which is I guess I'd call the black box approach. It says, do this project, and I'll look forward to your report at the end of the semester, right? And sometimes the reports are good, sometimes they're bad, but I'm really not at all sure what the team has done, or I can tell what the team has done. Two people have done it, and three people have not. And since I grade the team's product as a whole, then and I think that's actually the best way to do team grading, that leads to obvious problems. So I think it's much better. But it's also more time-consuming. I'll be in the comments here. There's a trade-off here. You know, there's much better to make sure you set expectations and focus on what, as Anna said, effort. You know, as much as output. Focus on effort and time commitments, and try to make sure that they're as equal as possible. And then task delineation. I think the professor has to be involved in understanding what the tasks are that the various students are doing and how they plan to do it in terms of scheduling. I also feel, maybe this is something we could talk about, that it's sometimes useful to get someone who is less capable to do a task to do it rather than someone who is more capable to do the task. Now, it's sort of hard a priori for me to know who that is, but you usually can figure out within a couple weeks. And so if your team starts later in the semester, you can sort of think about that. Now, that can meet resistance in the group. Someone says, no, I want to do this because I'll do a better job. And so that takes some finessing and coordination to try to encourage people who you think could use the practice more than the people who already know how to do this. That means grading can't be just on the quality of the output, but also on sort of the whole process, if you're going to go that route, because you might be purposely getting a less good result by trying to give some people training. And I strongly agree that this can't be a majority of your grade. It has to be a certain significant, but smallish percentage of the grade, so that you can also have individual assessments about what people are learning and how they're doing, or I think the course gets undermined. And then I think the professor, us, we have to be constantly checking in to see what's going on. Sometimes I've done that, sometimes I haven't. And if you go the teamwork route, then you have to think about what other assessments you normally do that you might need to take out so that you have room to devote the time to making sure the teamwork is done well. So I'll just stop.
Thank you. Gabe, would you like to step
in? Following right along with John and the issue of time, there's no question that sort of setting up this kind of an assignment that I'm going to describe is something of a time sink. Remember, what I'm after in this cooperative learning activity is a mutual interdependence, an engagement, and a valuing of everybody's contribution. So this is, I most recently did this in a class, general education class, 200 level, gender and transnational perspective. About 30 students. I don't know that this was deliberate, but this was the focus of this was status of women in Arab countries. The idea is to define 3 to 5 social indicators, identify data sources on those indicators, interpret and present the data, and even go to the point of making some kind of policy recommendation. So, what are the skills required? And this is sort of part of the group formation. The skills are finding and mining data and statistics, understanding concepts and measures of women's status and gender inequality, knowledge about the region and country context, how to formulate policy recommendations, and then finally sort of a synthesis presentation skill set. So I ask students, these are the skills that are required, what of these skills do you have, or are you willing to expand, to promote, to learn more about? And so groups are put together on the basis of the skills that people have or are willing to develop in these 5 areas. Then there are sort of 2 phases to this. All of the people who, in the 6 groups, who are working on data mining meet together to work on this issue of data mining as in terms of the others. The synthesis presentation people are a little more doing coordinating at the beginning, but that's still, they do have some discussions about how to do what's going to have to come together at the end and make presentations. So there's meetings among the people who have in a skill set. Then the groups, the country groups, come together, and the point of this is that whether the student is weak, strong, black, white, Arab, from the Arab world, person of color from the U.S., whatever, that everybody has a piece that will contribute to the success of the group. Nobody has all the pieces. Nobody can take it over in the sense that, unless somebody is just absolutely a control freak, and some of those folks are around. But basically, this is a mutual interdependence kind of thing whereby the data mining people, the measurement of the concepts and measurement people, the policy recommendation, the pieces have to be brought together under the coordination of the synthesis and presentation people. It takes time. It takes time in class because students are busy and it's got to happen in class. And to get to this issue, for me, this is, and other people have said this, is about process. Yes, there is an outcome because I don't think we can just say, okay, guys, this is all about process. They got to be going somewhere. But, so yes, there is a final outcome here. But the other piece of this is that therefore, I assess on process as well as product. The process assessment is largely done in terms of the students themselves, and they know this from the get-go. There's a rubric. They're going to assess on communication, they're going to assess on engagement, and they're going to assess on mutual regard. These are the dimensions on which they're going to assess the people, the work of their peers in the group. And this is something that does get debriefed, discussed, because the point is debriefing the process. And I will say, they hand in paper to me on this stuff, and I don't give everyone in the group the same grade. I do not. If there have been people who are identified as having been problematic, and then they've not come to me, this channel of communications does indeed need to be open, but if at the very end we're still getting something where somebody has sort of fallen down and other people have had to kind of pick up, even in this very mutually interdependent, deliberately cooperative setup. I don't give the same grade to everybody. I just don't. It doesn't seem right or fair. And I do have some suggestions about resources if you want to hear those later.
Thank you.
Great.
Dave, yeah.
Thank you. So I mentioned before the idea of setting conditions. My approach is governed by sort of two overriding ideas. The first one is that leaders are to set the conditions for the team to be successful. And in this case, the teacher is the leader, right? Yes, there are individual teams, but we're teaching them this process, so we should think of ourselves as the leader. Hence, we have to do things that set those conditions. The second is that you can tell a team what to do, but you can't tell a team how to do it. Now, I know that kind of goes against our thinking that, oh, we can micromanage people, but the fact of the matter is the team dynamic will form based on the team dynamic, and they're going to do what they're going to do. So you have to find certain ways of kind of manage this process, and I have a few of them. The first one kind of builds off this idea of interdependency that Joy talked about. I guess I'm the outlier in this group. My team percentage, rather the team assignments that I have for a course constitute 50% of the grade. And the reason I do that is because in the real world, a lot of what they're going to be doing is team projects. And oh, by the way, if the project fails, the team failed. And in fact, I even push that to the point where students really need to manage the issues. I've actually had teams that have made the decision they would throw a student off the team, in which case the student would get an F for the course because it was a team-based course. But the team decided to do that. So I think the team has to take some level of ownership, and this idea of creating interdependency is important. Grading is one way to do it. I think a second thing that we need to do is to make, and again, I realize this can't apply to all courses, but we need to make teamwork persistent throughout the course.
Yeah.
In other words, it can't just be an assignment, although that's not bad. It needs to be a lot of little different iterations of things that persist throughout the course so that we're teaching them one of two things, either how the same team can develop and form over time, or if we choose a case where we form a team, break it up, form another team for an assignment, how they can learn to form teams quickly. Right? Both of those are usable skills. And I think that consequently we want to do that in a way that doesn't let them think that, well, this is one assignment, the same way, and consequently they devalue it. The third thing that I do is try to vary the types of assignments that they have. So yeah, we all sort of look forward to that end of semester presentation that they do in the case or whatever it is that you have. But I have them do a number of things in between. I have them write a team reflection paper after something. A team reflection paper, not individual, team reflection paper. I have a team present a team rap song on one of the courses. They have to create a rap song. I have team members present the weekly lectures in the class, and it's part of the team grade. So you have to just, I think, throw a number of things at them so that the team is constantly having to operate as a team in different circumstances, right? Because different circumstances are going to arise in the workplace. The fourth area kind of goes back to something that a couple of my colleagues here on the panel have talked about, which is we have to show them the way to do it. So there's a couple of things that I do. The most formal one is something known as a team charter. So at the beginning of the session, I have them form a team charter. And in that team charter, they talk about certain things, their roles, individual strengths and weaknesses, and most importantly, the behavioral norms they are going to follow and the consequences they are going to impose if they're not followed. So in other words, if the norm is you will turn in work on time and a student doesn't do that, how is the team going to manage that? Now, the initial assignment of the team charter, then they return the team charter to me, I evaluate it, give them comments back. They come back to me and give me comments again, and that finally forms the charter in which we manage. Midway through the course, I give them an assessment where they basically see how it's working, and from that, they have to further adjust the charter. But this idea that you're continually dialoguing, right? You're continually looking at what you're doing and trying to reinforce it. So you're forcing those kinds of things. The final is, and I know that there's some concern about this idea of assigning a team grade. I have no issues assigning a team grade because, as I said, in the real world, if a project fails, it doesn't matter that you are the superstar. I mean, I worked for a company once where I was brilliant, but I got laid off because the whole company went bankrupt. You know, what are you going to do? So there's a couple things that we can do to mitigate that. I think we have to make it clear at the outset that it's a team grade, why it's a team grade. We have to publish the rubrics and be very clear and very, very, we'd have to adhere to that. I think we have to give them a couple different kinds of assessments. You talked about what is essentially a peer evaluation. So a peer evaluation counts for part of their grade. And we have to do it in a way where it's not a five, they know that a five is high and a one is low. We have to be a little more subtle about that. And I think we also have to kind of get them to self-evaluate the team's effectiveness and take some accountability for that. So, I'm sorry if I went over a little bit, but so a number of things that I think really require a lot of work, but to John's point, we have to really focus on making the process almost more important than the product, right? You know, because that's what they're going to learn and keep carry on, right? The fact that they did it well on a case is great, but the fact that they can take this skill and reapply it, I think, is even greater. So that's what I'm all about.
Thank you. There are a couple of things I just wanted to mention very quickly that were not touched by the other comments here, and one is the use of team leadership. And so I do make it a point to assign a team leader, and that team leader rotates. So one of the requirements of using leadership as an effective team learning school is to have multiple assignments over the course of the semester. And the number of assignments that I provide the students is the minimum number should be at least one student having an opportunity to exercise leadership over one assignment. And so that determines the number of team assignments I have each semester for the class, a minimum of one, ideally two or more. And so they rotate leaderships. The other important part about exercising leadership is the incentives you give these leaderships, the leader. I have so far experimented with just positive incentives. So if the team output proves to be a B+, A- or more, I give extra credit to the team leader. He's responsible, he or she is responsible for coordinating and delivering the final output. But what I've not experimented with and I'd like to is negative incentives, because in the real world, you are accountable and responsible to a particular quality of the team output, and I'm not sure how that would go down with the students, maybe one assignment. And the other important thing is that the team leaders constantly rotate. One last thing, I also use low-stake peer evaluation surveys twice, once mid-semester and one towards the end of the semester. And the purpose is for them to sort of both self-assess, but more importantly recognize, because I have multiple team assignments, that there's a reputation capital to be built up. So, and it also reinforces, these three elements reinforces a way to discourage shirking, because it encourages reciprocity. A student who's a potential shirker will be aware that, or should be aware that when his or her tenure for leadership comes up, the other students may be less cooperative, and I find that usually is quite effective. So let me open up the remaining part to the time we have here to your questions and see, so let's address some issues that we have not addressed.
I believe so far we're from Club C is the Wageman Heckman TDI, the first, team diagnostic index. Like there's a. It was interesting and stimulating, and I'm trying to do the same thing on the student club side. And I've gone so far as trying to administer team dimensions index on Wageman's three tenets of a good team. Mm. Sort of helping them understand, goals and vision and structure and coaching. And it's been interesting the resistance of our students, and even in a club setting where they know they have to do the work with more than two or three people, the reticence around what it means to work with a team, even when there's no grade on the line or no pay, that, how they take that on, see that as a challenge. But it's best to hear Heckman coming up in your conversation is stimulating because I'm on the right track. But it's,
Yeah, if you're doing anything Heckman said, you're on the right track.
So not a question as much as a comment there.
A question for you, actually. Do you see anything systematic about those who are more or less reluctant to engage?
It's been interesting. I've surveyed the club leaders, presidents and directors, because American, they like to assign directors to delegate responsibilities down. There's a lot of frustration around students not doing what they tell them to do. So the frustration is that they don't even understand the delegation, co-production, or co-creation. They think of it as an intellectual thing that they've thought about, and they say, now go do it. And then they're frustrated when their peers don't do it. So my challenge is peer-to-peer leadership and how they have to think about that different as opposed to the hierarchical sort of stuff that they're operating under.
Bobby, you want to?
Yeah, I have a question for you. Autonomy in the team. Mm-hmm. I've used teams a lot, and I think the work that you're doing is great. The way people learn to work on teams is they work on teams, practice. Mm-hmm. But how about you've given them a rubric, you've assigned the team, you've given them the assignment, you're observing it, and you know that there's like one person who's slacking. They're really not keeping up. You can tell by what's coming in, they're really not keeping up their side of the bargain. But the team is not mentioning this to you. They're not telling on these person. And now it's time to give the grades. How much autonomy do you give that team versus insight into the individual performance? I mean, you know somebody's fallen down on the job. I'm just trying to get
anybody or any directing that at anyone?
Anybody.
Anybody?
Go ahead, Dave.
My philosophy is that the team needs to account for itself, and part of the growth I think we're trying to stimulate in our students is the right kind of a critical nature where they call a spade, where they see something that works and, you know, commend that, and something that doesn't work and try to change that. The concern I have is that any perspective I'm going to have into the team's operation is going to be inferior because I can't see every action they take and I can't know every reason. And even when students bring problems to me, well, she's not doing this, he's not doing that, I'm always hearing just a partial story. So I really tend to throw it back on them. Now, I think from my perspective, that would then kind of force us to say, well, you know, are we challenging the team in the right way to, you know, exercise people? I mean, this idea of rotating leadership, that slacker is ultimately going to make the whole team accountable. You know, at some point, the team's going to care for that. And I think that's really the issue, but in my mind, it's sort of a philosophical divide. You know, how much do I want to meddle in the team's, meddle is the wrong word, how much do I want to involve myself in the team versus how much do I want the team to learn to be a team? And so maybe that's how Pilot rationalized it too, but that's kind of the way I go.
Dave, you raised something provocative, which really made me think, what is our responsibility? You said you grade the team with one grade, no matter how poorly one of the team members performed.
Well, most of the assignments are team assignments, so the team output is, it's a team output that I'm grading, not a team. So if it's poor, I'm cutting your question, I'm sorry.
If there's a shirker who does absolutely no work, so or close to nothing, or even 50%, but really, what is our responsibility as a university, as professors, in terms of grading, because grading is an individual assessment. I traditionally have penalized the shirkers, and so. But you raise a provocative question: is there some larger guideline that we should adhere to in terms of?
Yeah, I can't speak for the university, of course. I mean, I think that part of the, you know, I would never really don't like going over 50% because. The other 50% is individual work, right? And again, I have to frame this. I teach an OB class, right? So teamwork is a component of what we teach, and teamwork is a component of what we should be doing. So maybe I can rationalize it better that way in terms of the team output. I wouldn't want to impose that on statistics or something like that. But I think it does raise a provocative question. What is the learning outcome we're trying to achieve in an OB class? And to my mind, it's not. In another class, it might be a different sort of issue.
But the larger question is, what is the responsibility? Because the assessment of the individual student is of the individual student's work.
Well, but part of their work might be how well their team produces something in a group. That's why I wouldn't ever teach a course unless it was a course just on teamwork, in which 100% of the grade would be on teamwork. But see, I mean, if someone is shirking, I think it can be a complicated question, because why are they shirking? Is it because someone overbearing in the group identifies them as weak and sort of pushes them out? Or is it because they're just shirkers and lazy? It could be both, you know, but I think it's complicated. question for identifying the person who's not doing the work, which is, I think, an issue that Gay was sort of implicitly raising, sort of the biases that people bring into these works, teamwork. So I guess my own solution is just to try to get a clear sort of contract about what each member of the group's going to be doing, and then trying to observe that as best I can, whether they are doing it, but trying to get the team itself to, in negotiation, to identify what their different tasks are within the group, and trying to identify those students who might not be contributing as much as they could be contributing.
I've also wrestled with this question, what do you do? Well, first I'm thinking of one particular course I'll be teaching this semester. I have a lot of individual assessments, but for the first time what I've done for my team assessment is I do believe that everybody should get the same grade because it is the team's responsibility. I mean, that's part of learning teamwork.
Yeah.
You've got to make the team work in some way. But I've also reduced the percentage of what it's worth. I mean, it's way lower than I normally do, and I'm just trying that out to see. And so the rest of the course is various individual assessments, but everybody gets the same grade. But the question I had, so that's sort of to that, but the question I had, so much of teamwork, or the essence of teamwork, is really this social intelligence. It's this emotional and social intelligence. And so my question to the panel would be, how do you teach that, or can you teach that?
Well, if I can take up both questions here on the shirking part too, it's very rare to find in a student who would be a constant shirker and an unrepentant shirker throughout the semester and also fail to recognize that that shirking is going to not be caught at some in some way or the other. And if there are such students, there's not much you can do, but you've got to then respond to the students who do step up on the plate and say, that's still a worthwhile experience to go through to manage the shirking and still come ahead. But for most cases, and that's why multiple team and varied team assignments and rotating leadership, in most cases, these shirkers learn to step up because of group pressure, because of social sanctions. One additional tool I use is to once or twice, so I will select the teams. I take charge of that. That's the extent of micromanagement I do. The rest of it, I'm hands off. But I set the systemic incentives at the macro level. But I will select the team and make sure that there's a good element of diversity represented in terms of skills, gender, in terms of nationalities, and so on. But at one point, I will ask students to self, once or twice, they'll be given the opportunity to self-select those teams. And when that happens, that they feel the pinch of social sanctions if there's a shirker in there. But I don't do that very often. Yeah.
If I can, just to your point, and by the way, I'm in no means trying to rationalize away my decision to go 50%, but I'm not sure your point doesn't apply to 35% or 15% or 20% if, in fact, the charter of the university is to assign individual assessment.
It's not the percentage of the grade, but it is...
the bigger issue.
It's the bigger issue.
Yeah, I understand.
You have a question?
One comment I have about the team autonomy, you have one grade for a whole team, is that in the real world, in my experience, there is a power differential within the team. Somebody's in charge and is responsible for the team's behavior and can sanction people for not performing. And not just in an artificial way, as in declaring some student in within a group to be in charge for that moment. They will continue to be in power after the group's work is done because they hold a higher position, more seniority, something like this. So even when you declare a student to be in charge for now, they are actually peers. They may have more classes with each other. They may socialize together. So it seems very difficult to me to give one group grade and say the group is responsible for all their self-regulating when the people within it are peers and nobody is in charge. And nobody actually has the ability to sanction anybody for doing anything. It doesn't follow over later because they're peers, because they might socialize or might run into each other in another class. So it seems to me that the idea of some sort of individual grading makes a lot more sense when there's no power differential.
Let's take one more question.
I just want to follow up on that. I get the same point basically, but I mean, I teach a class that's required, and so
So some students come in with different goals. Not every student's goal is to get an A in the class. And so this is a really challenging thing with teamwork, because, you know, people have different goals, and there's not a good way to accommodate this. And I thought really hard about it, and what I came up with was offering a very small percentage of extra credit for team participation superstars who work to, you know, smooth over communication gaps and, you know, make the team run smoothly and things like that. And then at the end, there's an assessment of who did how much work, and I get that sort of number at the end where they sort of say, okay, I did, if it's a pair, half of the work, or if it's three, 33% of the work, or whatever. And you can get a little bit of that information at that point. But that's the big issue I've struggled with teaching a required class where people come in with different kinds of goals, and you have to put them on, you want to put them on diverse teams, but that's a particular challenge in diversity to deal with.
It's time to wrap up.
Sure. Maybe take one quick question.
All right, question. So you had the point of a student that came to you at the end and said, basically, I've done all the work, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Or someone did no work. This happened to me not about my course, but someone else's. And I was so frustrated. I'm like, why didn't you come before? But then if you think about it, she actually got the most value out of her money for the course. So in terms of, you know, what the university is providing, you know, you can see the grade. Maybe some people on the course didn't earn, her team didn't earn that grade, but they really missed out in other ways. And then I'm hoping that the woman that came at the end and said, I did all the work, that she realized she did fail in some ways, but she didn't bring this to anyone's attention earlier. You know, that
Absolutely.
She didn't bring it, you know, or try to come up with those, you know, what are the sanctions going to be, or what are, you know, what happens when people aren't following through. So, you know, it was a painful lesson, but I think kind of everyone got what they deserve.
That's a great point. Yeah, I think, especially in professional schools, we try to mimic the real life experience, and we can't perfectly do that. There are limitations to setting up the same conditions and the roles, etc. But even in the cases when we assign group grade, and actually in this case I did assign a different grade, partly because four other members of the team provided written statements to me saying that this person did not do any part of the statistical analysis. And so I documented it carefully, and he never had a question about his lower grade and the team knowing that that's what he has done. And he was actually a smart shirker. He did very well on the individual midterm and final exam. So some of them are smart shirkers.
Yeah.
But I think we basically, by assigning a team grade, we're assigning their individual grade for their participation in the group process. And if the outcome is not good enough, then their participation was not perfect. They were not able to manage someone else's participation. They could have written that person's part. They could have edited the entire paper better. We've all stepped in and done something that another person, and they chose not to do that. So I think there are ways to mitigate that, and we're still assigning an individual grade for their group performance.
Well, we've run out of time, so I'd like to thank all of my colleagues for participating in this, and all of you for your great questions. Thank you.